Appreciate the song tonight. It means everything to know you are alive. He keeps his promises. Because he lives tonight, each one of us have a hope of living. Because his blood was spilled, he come forth in resurrection power. It validates everything that he said. I can have assurance of salvation. It's not just a facade, but it's a confidence in the Word of God. An experience in the Spirit of God. Let me just share a couple of things of my week. I was with a woman who is dying. No, I wanted to bring hope, and I said, I don't know how you want me to pray, but I'm going to pray. I'm going to pray that God will heal your body, because I believe that where there's life, there is hope.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. And so, in conversation as it went on, she began to validate to me the confidence that she had in God, that should she not be healed and it didn't look good, it would be nothing short of a miracle, that she knew that she would be in the presence of God. So we talked about the things of God. We talked about life and reflection of being in church and the move of God's Spirit and reflection of the years. And we grabbed hands with that man and woman, and we began to pray. The presence of God just came down in that room, and tears began to flow, and the Holy Spirit just began to work and began to move. When we were done, I just had to stand there quietly because I didn't know what else to say or think or do. You know why we can experience those moments? Because of the work of Christ upon the cross. Amen. I was talking to a lady who I worked with. She had collaboration with through where I worked, and her husband passed away very unexpectedly. And so she came to visit me at work. She didn't tell me something, show me something. And so I began to say to her, "How are you doing? How's everything going? I know that your loss was sudden. Your loss was great." And she began to weep, and tears ran down her face. And she said to me, she said, "I cannot begin to even tell you what God has done for me. If it were not for God, even though it hurts and even though I miss, if it wasn't for God." Let me tell you, that's what today is all about. I know that we come and we celebrate Easter, but that's why we worship on the first day of the week every week, because we are celebrating a resurrected Savior who brings hope in every situation. When life becomes great and situations become overwhelming, there is hope in God.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. And when life is uncertain, our certainty can be in the Christ of Calvary and the finished work of Calvary. Thank God for the cross. Thank God for the empty tomb.
Amen.
I want to look tonight at Luke chapter number 24. I'm going to be working my way back to these synoptic gospels. Once again, I'm not going to include John just because of our Bible study. We're looking more at that on Tuesday evening. Amen. Praise God. Boy, I love the Lord. Let me just share this little tidbit with you. Sometimes I just have to share who I am. And not that this is about me, it's not, but I just have to share because I know my story best. You know, the greatest thing that I want, and I find it is a challenge, is I want my family to make it to heaven. You know, even at a young age, I want my girls to fall in love with Jesus and see an example of Jesus in our life. And, you know, sometimes, you know, it's tough pastoring and having children. You know, tonight I'm trying to keep them quiet and, you know, just trying to bring that balance. But we decided, because they love the microphones so much, we decided we saw some microphones clearance. And so Sister Jen, they were just a good deal. We decided we got to get these microphones for our girls for Easter. Like, they need more candy, right? So we are the crazy parents, or we didn't really buy any candy, but maybe one pizza in their basket, right, babe? And so we got them these microphones, Brother Dennis, and they were enjoying them. They're on little platforms, and we gave it to them after church. And they put them up, and Sister Beth, we were letting them play with them. And I was tired. I was sitting on the floor. My wife was sitting on the floor. And as they were playing, I was getting some texts from my family and my wife's family. We were both kind of looking at our phones. And Brother Justin, they were there, and they were singing in their microphones. And the next thing I knew, Brother Doug, I looked up, and Brindley's singing. Oh, her hands are raised and her eyes are closed. Amen. Amen. It's really about an experience with the Savior that makes a difference. God help us to practice Jesus every day. Amen. Chapter number 24 of Luke. The Bible says, now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, came unto the sepulcher. Or they came unto the sepulcher, bouncing back to the previous chapter, verse number 55. We see those women that were there, bringing the spices which they had prepared, and certain other with them. They were not aware that Jesus was going to be resurrected from the grave. Why would they spend all this money on spices? They forgot about who he was and what his promise was. The Bible says, and they found the stone rolled away from the sepulcher. Let's just stop right there for a moment. I'm going to be just dissecting as I work through both, all three of these chapters, and then we're going to be having communion tonight. Do you understand the value of what the Word of God says? Brother George, this isn't a stone that we can just push with our knee or our foot and roll. Brother Justin, we're talking about several hundred pounds. It was probably a question to these ladies. There were several of them that are coming, but it's probably a question, how are we going to move this stone? But God had already moved the stone. Amen. They were coming. They weren't expecting the stone, Sister Dead, to be moved. They were coming thinking, how are we going to move, and how are we going to get in there with that body and put these spices on that body, Brother Steve? The Bible says, and they entered in where the stone had rolled away, and they found not the body of our Lord Jesus. Amen. This is a resurrection title, Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as much as they were much perplexed, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And they were afraid and bowed down their faces to the earth. And they said unto them, why seek ye the living among the dead? There's a little bit of a rebuke here that's given to them. Why are you seeking the living among the dead? Christ is risen. He is not here, but he is risen. Remember how that he spoke unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day rise again. And then they remembered his words. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit more about this before communion. But it's easy to forget sometimes the things of God, the Word of God, the things God speaks to us in prayer. Sometimes it's easy to forget. And if we're not careful, we'll forget about the price that was paid for our sins. The rugged cross, the empty tomb, we can very easily forget. And so here it was, these ladies, they came, they were heartbroken, they were feeling the loss. You know how it is in your life when someone that you loved and so valuable and special to you, and then their life is taken into eternity. You experience that loss, and sometimes there's kind of a disillusionment when there's someone so close to you, and you love them and you appreciate them and you value time with them. And when it happens so suddenly, so quickly, it Brother Eli, it just kind of rocks our world. So their world has been rocked, and they go and they spend a value of money to get these spices, and they come and they're in mourning, and Brother Justin, they're looking and thinking, how are we going to move the stone? And they come and the stone is rolled away. The angel of the Lord, they're fearful, they look down, said, don't be afraid. Why do you seek the living among the dead? Brother Doug, then he brought back to their remembrance what Jesus said. And then they remembered. It's important for us tonight to remember. To remember Calvary. To remember a Savior. To remember the blood that was spilled. To remember the body that was broken. To remember the empty tomb, that He is Lord. Let's turn back to Mark. Chapter number 16. The Bible says, and when the Sabbath was passed, all this remembering the seventh day of God as they hold to that Saturday Sabbath, understand that the Sabbath being passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the other mother of James, and Salome, remember that is Jesus' aunt, had brought sweet spices that they might come and anoint Him. They didn't believe He was going to rise from the dead. They had forgotten. Once again tonight, it's important to remember. And very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre at the rising of the sun. And they said among themselves, who shall roll away the stone from the door of the sepulchre? Once again, it's heavy. Who's going to roll it away? And when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. Once again, several hundreds of pounds. And entering into the sepulcher, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment. Right here speaks something to us, because there was no tradition, commentators say at this time, where a man would ever wear a long white garment. It wasn't an ordinary man. It was an angel.
Mm-hmm.
And they were frightened. He said unto them, be not affrighted. Don't fear. For Jesus, you seek Jesus of Nazareth, who is crucified. He is risen. Amen. The greatest statement that's ever been made in all of history. He is risen. He is not here. Amen. Death did not have a hold on Him. Hell did not have a hold on Him. The grave did not have a hold on Him. He is victorious.
Amen.
The place, He is not here. Behold the place where they laid Him. They look and see the place. But go your way, tell His disciples and Peter. Why does He say Peter? This is interesting here to me. He says Peter because of this. Because, Sister Beth, Peter had fallen miserably. He had sinned, Brother Steve. But he had repented. God says, I see his repentance. And because of that, tell Peter. That he goes before you into Galilee, and there shall ye see him as he said unto you. Let's look at Matthew chapter number 28. The Bible says, in the end of the Sabbath, as it begins to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. It's interesting, we have to read all these Gospels to get all the folks in and to get a complete picture. The Bible says that now something happens for the second time. Amen. It happened when Christ died, but now it happens again. And behold, there was a great earthquake, and the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door. Amen. We're seeing it even different. Amen. They heard an earthquake. They felt an earthquake. Can you imagine? Even Hollywood couldn't depict this in the most appropriate way. It sounds like an earthquake, Brother Rich. Amen. Here the angel of the Lord comes, and Sister Barbara, it was the angel of the Lord that moves back the stone, the Bible says. Can you imagine? I don't believe he's grunting. I don't think he was spitting and sputtering, but in great majesty and power, the angel rolls the stone back. Now let me stop right here. We're going to go on and read, Brother Doug, but we're going to notice that he's already gone. He's not in there. He's already resurrected even before the angel of the Lord appeared. Remember this, Brother Justin, he has a glorified body. Mm-hmm. He's not subject to a big stone being at the entrance of the tomb or the cave. He can walk right through that stone. He's already risen. Christ is risen indeed. The Bible says, and when they came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it, and his countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers, or those Roman guards, did shake and become as dead men. And the angel, the Bible says, answered and said unto the women. I'm using some of my own verbiage here to make it easy. Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus, which was crucified. Amen. Crucified, the manner in which he said, he is not here, for he is risen. And he said, come and see the place where the Lord lay. And go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. Well, let me just throw away a few things that some folks may want to get confused on. You know, they might want a Sister Tina to say that they stole the body of Jesus. Well, if they were thieves, Brother Justin, why did they take time to take the linen cloth off of him and put it to the side? They were going to steal that body. They were going to be as incognito as possible. They were going to get in there. They were going to get that body. They were going to get out. But Jesus didn't need those grave clothes any longer. He came forth in resurrection power. There's something that the angel of the Lord and these gospel writers are so vivid in telling us. They said, you didn't remember. You forgot. You didn't remember. You forgot. I've heard stories before of people taking off while they're on the trip. They go to a bathroom break and they take off driving and they forget someone at the rest stop. You ever hear that? Yeah, they forget. Didn't even notice the absence of someone. Friday, I know it was a busy weekend. We had been late here on Thursday evening getting things ready for fellowship. I was tired, still needed to get some things together. The weather was beautiful. But Brother Dennis, I had worn my coat to work. And I put it on my chair at work. I had thrown my wallet inside my chair. I pulled in to the house, Sister Deb, and immediately when I hit the driveway, guess what I remember? My coat and wallet is still in the back of my office chair. Like I had time with Sister Tina on Friday evening. But it's all because I didn't remember. Do you realize that our world are full of sticky notes to help us to remember? Any of you ever set alarms or notices on your phone to help you remember? Any of you have a calendar you lay out so that you will remember? Remember the time, remember the date, remember the activity. All those, there's some things that we will remember, but there's some things, Sister Beth, that we tend to forget. In fact, it is said from research by Karen Bola of John Hopkins, she said that people have a tendency to forget. In fact, people have a tendency by 81% to forget people's names. I work a job where I always have a chart and I have a name in front of me. So it looks good, Sister Tina. I always look like I know the person that I'm going out to talk to. But man, when I see them at Walmart, or I see them at the gas station, or I see them at the dentist, I gotta fish until I can figure it out because I forget. You with me? And then my wife, she's out, praise the Lord. John Hopkins says that 60% of people forget where something is. I spend a lot of time looking for things. Yes, forget where something is. Now, I know that we live in the day of cell phones, but they say that 57% of people forget phone numbers. I don't know anybody's phone number anymore, mine and my wife's. That's about it. And John Hopkins says that 53% of people forget words. 49% of people forget what's said. I'll be having a quiz after the message tonight. They say that 42% of people forget faces, and 38% of people forget what they just did. Okay, let's have a, we're in God's house tonight. No one's ever walked into a room and you get there and think, what did I come to this room for? Because we have a tendency to forget. Everything in an industry around creates things for us to remember. As I said, sticky notes, cell phones, calendars, reminders on our computer. Microsoft has it set up. Man, when I'm at work, Brother Dennis, sometimes from Wednesday to Wednesday, I don't remember what meetings I need to be at the hospital. But thank God for our secretary. She plugs all my meetings in. And you know what, Spertina? Those little notices come out. Even when I'm out before my iPad, bing, bing, you need to be here in a half an hour. Makes me look good because I would have forgot. And Jesus knew that. So he said that with the cup and with the bread, he wanted us to remember. It's easy to forget. Easy to forget. Tonight, I just want us together, and I knew that we were going to have a low crowd. I was aware of that because of activities. I want it to be very intimate. I want it to be very personal. But I want it to be a time where we remember. If we could tonight, Brother Justin, can you just throw that CD, number 5, just throw it on real low. We come together in the first couple of pews. Brother Justin, can you just flip that middle light off? Amen. We're going to salvage some of these candles here from Christmas. Come on out. Amen. Let's gather in. We're going to do it a little bit different tonight, communion. But our difference is this, that we are going to take time tonight to remember. To remember. I don't know, there's something about, for me, it's very emotional to remember what Christ has done for me. And it's important to remember. There's a lot of things we need to remember, Sister Tina. We need to remember our work schedules.
Brother Dennis and Sister Sandy, you got a big old family now, lots of branches in those family trees. I'm sure that you have a way of remembering all those birthdays you write down because they're important to remember. But God wanted us to remember the most important thing, that He died for us. His body was broken. With His blood, we have the remission of sins when we confess our sins and accept Him as our Savior. We need to remember. One day, Sister Barbara, we are going to be drinking of this cup and eating of this bread with Him in His kingdom. He wants us to remember. So Brother Doug, if you would, could you just pass everybody a candle tonight? If you'll help them light it, however, Stephen, if you want to help in some way. Amen. So Justin, you can start that music and just let it roll. Amen. And join us up here for your life.